Thank you for the opportunity to be here. We are going to debate the question, does Christianity harm women? The other question before us this evening is there a problem with women in the new atheist movement? My name is Karen Garst. You may find me at www.faithlessfeminist.com. I am taking the affirmative position. First, I'd like to talk a little bit about what is feminism. There are three waves of feminism, according to cultural scholars. The first involves the right to vote, and that came out of the abolition movement and developed into the women's rights movement and secured the right to vote in 1920. These are the times of Sojourner Truth, Ain't I a Woman's speech. Imagine Susan B. Anthony slammed to the sidewalk by the police. They worked for decades to secure women the right to vote, and that's considered the first wave. The second wave occurred in the 60s and 80s and is involved with issues like wage parity, when we started to talk about equal pay for equal work among the genders. Also involved in reproductive rights. In 1973, the U.S. Supreme Court issued its decision in Roe v. Wade. And also redefining family roles and the discussion of maternity and then later paternity leave. The people you know from this era are Betty Friedan, Germaine Greer, Gloria Steinem, and Coretta Scott King. The third wave is thought to have started in the 1990s. This blended a lot of issues in addition to issues of gender equality. Race, how did that impact women's rights? Gender identity, how did people who did not identify as heterosexual fit in? Were they transgendered? Were they lesbians? Were they gay? How did that add to the discussion of feminism? And it's often called intersectionality, where all of these things work together. So with that brief introduction to feminism, let's talk about Christianity's impact on women. The first impact of Christianity on women is the elimination of the female divine. As far back as the Paleolithic, we can see figurines predominantly of females, often pregnant, large breasts, etc., where there was some veneration of the female. This is the person who gave birth. This helped the tribe continue. And then later on, we have Greek mythology, where we have a very strong goddess in Demeter, the grain goddess, who had power in her own right. When monotheism came along, this was an abrupt break with having a female divine, and it eliminated any notion of the feminine. Interestingly enough, as the Hebrews developed monotheism, this was also happening in other cultures. For example, in Babylonia, Marduk made a deal with the other gods, male, that said, hey, if you make me supreme god, I'll kill Tiamat, the female, and we'll be great. And it's interesting that, of course, the Hebrews, when they were exiled in Babylon, 586 BCE, they heard about this myth. That has had an impact on women ever since. Second, a very early focus on sex and sin. And I will give due credit to this to St. Augustine in the 5th century, who really promulgated the idea of original sin, linking it to lust or concupiscence, as he said, and tracing it back to Eve. So the association of sin with a female, with Eve, has been with us ever since. Third, the Virgin Mary is the model. Obviously, a lot of different myths had a virgin. A lot of different gods were born of a virgin. This was a meme that was going around. But what you see through Christianity is this female, the Virgin Mary, being elevated because of a thirst people had for a female divine. First of all, there's a virgin birth. Next, the concept comes along that the Virgin Mary herself was conceived, immaculate conception, as a without sexual relations. And then finally, the ascension, where she ascends into heaven. So there is some kind of need there that the Catholic Church tries to promote as it elevates the Virgin Mary. Fourth is a very sad story of atrocities. And I will talk particularly about the atrocities against women. Hypatia was a brilliant mathematician and philosopher in the 5th century. The Christians, this was in Alexandria, the Christian mob attacked her and skinned her with clamshells and obviously murdered her, as well as destroying the library in Alexandria. The Crusades killed hundreds of thousands of people, including women and children. And the Malleus Maleficarum was promulgated by the Catholic Church in the 15th century, which basically killed hundreds of thousands of predominantly women who were deemed to be witches. This was the same time the males were trying to enter the medical profession. Oh, and lo and behold, the women are the midwives, the women know the herbal remedies. So, isn't this a good way to eliminate them from this process? And then finally, you may have heard recently of the Madeleine Laundries in Ireland. This was a home for unwed mothers, and what they did was exploit them and have them work for free. They recently found 800 skeletons of babies that were deposited in a septic tank from 1925 to 1961. These babies died, young children died from malnutrition and TB. And we don't have time to continue this history. The legacy of patriarchy continues today. It wasn't until 1900 that all the states allowed women to own property. Pretty hard to catch up when you don't even get the right to own property until 1900. There are a lot of cultural legacies of patriarchy. For example, if you know and you have a daughter and her fiance comes and asks for you as the father, your hand in marriage, that traced back to the fact that the daughters used to be the property of the man and they had to have permission to take that property away from them. So even our cultural memes continue this impact on women. And then finally, the religious attacks on reproduction rights. Today, every single Republican candidate is against, including the only woman candidate, Carly Fiorina, is against Planned Parenthood, which provides birth control. They're against safe abortions. Even the Catholic Church, the Irish priests, are in opposition to the systematic oppression of women within the Catholic Church. And then finally, New Atheism's impact on women. I want to give credit to the Four Horsemen, Richard Dawkins, Daniel Dennett, Christopher Hitchens, and Sam Harris. They certainly raised the issue of atheism to a new level. I think one of the reasons that the men are featured more is a focus on science and philosophy, which has been predominantly, up until the last few decades, dominated by men, so it's not surprising. These people are philosophers or scientists. But there are many women's voices that just don't get to be heard. As an example, Christopher Hitchens credited the work of Jennifer Michael Hecht in his book, saying that her work, Doubt, A History, he owed a great debt to her. But have you heard of her? Do you see her? Is her name mentioned? No. Susan Jacoby is another author that is an incredible writer and has done a lot of work but doesn't have the stature that the Four Horsemen do. And then finally, Annie Laurie Gaylor is the co-president of the Freedom From Religion Foundation in Madison, Wisconsin, with her husband Dan Barker, and she often remarks that when somebody asks for a debate, they ask for Dan and not her, yet she has published a great deal in this field. One of the issues I think is neglected is talking about culture and how religion systematically subjugates women through the experience of religion. I am writing a book about 17 women experience in religion and how they were held back, how they were told to submit to their husband's wishes, how they were brainwashed about the world around them. And I think it's those issues that need to be more in the forefront. And I'm very happy to let you know that my book is going to be published probably in the fall or winter of 2016. Finally, I would just like to say that I have a blog at the address I previously said, www.faithlessfeminist.com. Its focus is on women and religion. I accept guest posts, in fact, encourage them. And if you decide to subscribe, all you have to do is leave your email. Nothing will happen to you. You won't get a nasty anything in the mail. I do send out a notice once a week about a new post, so you're notified of that. Thank you again.
Okay, thank you, Karen.